फ्रेंड्स, टुडेज लेक्चर इज अवर लेक्चर नंबर 3, ओके, एंड टुडे विल स्टार्ट द डिस्कशन फ्रॉम नवंबर 2019 सजेस्टेड आंसर। आई होप यू आर रेडी विथ योर प्रिंटेड कॉपी ऑफ नोट्स, पेन, रफ पेजेस एंड कैलकुलेटर, राइट? आई होप यू आर रेडी। लेट्स गो। क्वेश्चन 1, कंपल्सरी क्वेश्चन। दिस क्वेश्चन इज अगेन अ केस स्टडी, so naturally I will skip it, you will read it on your own. This case study is on not for profit organization, right? Not for profit organization case study is of a hospital, so you can read the case study and the answer at your leisure time. I won't waste your time here. We'll go to practical questions, actually, as we have planned that we'll discuss the practical questions if there is any difficulty. Case study is basically essay writing. Yeah, let's go to question number 2. Question number 2 from November 19 examination. I hope you are on page number 29, my dear friends. Oh, page number 34, sorry. Right, you are on page 34 now. Okay, I'll read out the question. Pixel Limited is a toy manufacturing company. It sells toys through its own retail outlets. It purchases materials needed to manufacture toys from a number of different suppliers. Recently, due to the entry of few reputed foreign brands in the toy market, and particularly in the segment in which Pixel Limited is doing the business, it is facing a threat to operate profitably. Each toy requires 4 kg of material at rupees 19 per kg. 19 per kg is the price and 4 kg is the standard quantity for each toy. And 5% of all the material supplied by the supplier are found to be substandard. Substandard means of low quality, which is not usable quality. It means you can treat 5% as a loss, 5% of the material supplied by the supplier. Labor hour required for each toy is 0.4 hour. At rupees 120 per hour, 0.4 hour for one unit, and the rate of labor is 120 per hour. Market research has determined that the selling price will be rupees 240 per toy. Selling price is 240 per toy. The company requires a profit margin of 15%, but 15% of selling price, please remember. They want a profit margin of 15% of selling price. Expected demand for the toy in the coming year will be 50,000 toys. The demand in the coming year will be 50,000 toys. Sales and variable overheads per unit. Overheads are given per unit. For the 4 quarters of the year will be as follows. So let us check the data given in the question. Particulars: quarter 1, quarter 2, quarter 3 and quarter 4. Sales is given in units, please remember. Sales is in units: 7,500, 9,000 units, 15,500 and 18,000 units. You will notice the sale of quarter 3 and 4 is higher because of the festival season, right? So there is some festival season. And variable overheads per unit are given. So variable overheads are given different for different quarters. It is 22, 22, 24 and 25. See, variable overheads are given here. Material cost is given up, that is 4 kg of material is required at 19 rupees per kg. Labor cost, they have given you the hours, 0.4 hours per unit and 120 per hour. And selling price is given. And in raw material, there is a 5% loss due to substandard quality of material supplied by the supplier. Okay, let's go ahead. The fixed overheads are expected to be 6,25,000 for each quarter. Right, these overheads are not relevant for decision making, but will be relevant for calculation of profit if they ask you to calculate the profit. And this 6,25,000 is for each quarter. Now, the production manager has decided to produce 12,500 units in each quarter, 12,500 units per quarter. Inventory holding cost, we call it as carrying cost of inventory, that is inventory holding cost, will be rupees 18 per unit of average inventory per quarter. Inventory carrying cost or holding cost, because it occupies the space and the money gets blocked, that carrying cost of inventory is 18 for one unit of average inventory. And this cost is not per annum, this is per quarter. Inventory holding costs are not included in the above. It means the above cost which is given for material, labor and variable overheads, that cost doesn't include the inventory holding cost. It means we have to take the inventory holding cost as a separate element of cost. So we'll take it separately. It is not given above. Now normal production capacity per quarter is 15,000 toys. This is normal capacity. So your machinery has a capacity to produce 15,000 toys per quarter. The company can produce further up to 6,000 units per quarter by resorting to overtime working. If you work overtime, you can produce further 6,000, means 15,000 in normal capacity plus 6,000 more. So it means you can produce maximum 21,000, 15,000 plus 6,000, 21,000 units in a quarter. But to produce additional 6,000 units, you have to work overtime. And overtime wages will be at 150% of normal wage rate. Overtime wages will be 150% of normal wage rate. So that extra 50% which you pay, see, normal wage rate into 100% will be same normal wage rate. Anything multiplied by 100% doesn't change. But that extra 50% which you are paying is called overtime premium. Extra payment of 50% is called overtime premium. And assume zero opening inventory. Opening stock is assumed to be zero. Now the question is, A question has got two sub questions, 1 and 2. So A1 says calculate the cost gap that exists between total cost per toy as per the production plan. Production plan is the plan which production manager has prepared already, and the target cost per toy. So what was your target cost and what is your cost per toy? Total cost will include, naturally, total cost will include variable cost plus fixed cost. Word is not variable cost, word is total cost. So total cost is naturally variable plus fixed together, but we want to convert it into per toy. So we'll calculate the, as per the existing plan, we will calculate the total cost per toy and we'll compare it with the target cost per toy and we'll find out the cost gap. That is question one. I think question two we'll read later on. Okay, and B also will see later. Let's go one by one. Now, just have a quick look at the question. We'll first discuss the question, because understanding of the question is always important in costing. What is asked and what we'll have to do and how we will go. So just go through the question again. The first part is telling you to calculate the cost gap between target cost and the present cost as per the present production plan. Actually, I had given you the instruction earlier that while before watching these video lectures, you can have one look at the question so you can form your opinion and then you can listen to my views also. So that will help you to develop the ability to read and interpret the question, which is the most important thing in this subject, reading and interpretation of question. Anyway, so I won't wait for much time, assuming that you have read it already once earlier. I'm directly starting the discussion. Now see, how much profit margin you wanted? 15% of selling price, it is here. And your expected selling price is 240 rupees. So selling price minus profit, 15% on sales price, will give you the target cost. Naturally, if you deduct the expected profit margin from sales price, you'll get the cost at which you should have produced, that is target cost. Then you'll have to calculate actual cost and compare it with the target cost to find out the gap. Now, to calculate the actual cost, what was the plan of the production manager? Production manager had decided to produce 12,500 units per quarter. Now, this will be production per quarter and sales is given here. Now, you will notice the quantity produced and quantity sold will mismatch. So, there will be some stock, carry forward of stocks. Now, just do one thing quickly. Take the total of this sales quantity from here. This 7,500 plus 9,000. Plus 15,500 and plus 18,000. Take the total of this sales quantity. Taken the total, I think it is 50,000. 50,000 units you were supposed to sell. It was written somewhere. Yeah, it's written here that the expected demand is 50,000 units. And see, the production manager is planning to produce 12,500 units per quarter. So 12,500 per quarter into 4 quarters. That will also be 50,000. And I think somewhere it was given opening stock is zero. Its opening inventory is zero. It's given here. It means no opening stock. You will produce 50,000, you will sell 50,000 units, so closing stock also will be zero. However, on quarterly basis, there will be some stock adjustment, which we will see while checking the answer. Now, when we develop the answer of what is the cost as per the present production plan, we will calculate the present production plan, we will put it in the tabular format, we will calculate the stock, from there we will calculate average stock, from average stock we will get the inventory holding cost also. And other than that, we will have to take the material cost, labor cost and variable overheads cost, plus fixed cost is fixed per quarter, and we will be able to get the current cost, and then we will be able to see the cost gap. Now calculations are already done, so I will explain it from there. Keep the question or data in front of you. Okay, I am moving to the answer now. Of first part only, A1, we are discussing this part, A1. See, calculation of target cost, for how many marks this question was? This was for 9 marks. Very good. According to me, this is bonus. Selling price minus profit, so 240 rupees is the selling price and 15% of selling price only is the expected profit margin. So 240 minus 15% on calculator, you will get 204 target cost. So at least 1 or 2 marks reserved for target cost is over. Now let's go further. Check, calculation of cost as per present production plan. At present, production manager has decided to produce 12,500 units in each quarter, irrespective of sales. This production is within normal capacity of 15,000 toys per quarter. If you remember, normal capacity is 15,000 toys and extra 6,000 can be produced using overtime. Now, as your production plan is within 15,000, no overtime wages will be incurred. Wages, normal wages has to be given. That premium, extra 50% will not be required to be paid. However, we'll have to incur the inventory holding cost on average inventory because the stock inventory will be there. So let us check the question. Inventory holding cost we'll calculate first in a working. I have taken 4 quarters. Opening stock for the first quarter I have assumed 0. Production each quarter 12,500. 0 plus 12,500 minus sales. Sales quantity I have picked up from the question, please remember, 7,500. So 0 plus 12,500 minus 7,500 sold, closing stock will be 5,000. This closing stock will become opening stock in the next quarter. Again in next quarter, you will produce 12,500 minus sales 9,000 I have taken from the question, right? You can keep an eye on the question. So you will get this closing stock. This closing stock will become opening stock for the third quarter plus production 12,500. Minus sales 15,500, closing stock will be 5,500. This will become opening stock next quarter plus 12,500 production. Production is uniform. Minus sales 18,000, closing stock will be 0. And this we had already tallied. You will produce 50,000, you will sell 50,000. And no opening stock, no closing stock. Okay. Now, how we'll get average stock? Average stock is opening stock plus closing stock divided by 2. Opening plus closing divided by 2. That is 0 plus 5,000 divided by 2. So average stock 2,500. Why we have to calculate average stock? To calculate the inventory holding cost. Because inventory holding cost is based on average inventory. Similarly, for quarter 2, 5,000 is opening stock, 8,500 closing stock, 5,000 plus 8,500 divided by 2. You should get this as a average stock 6,750. Is it okay? Do it for third quarter, opening stock 8,500 plus closing stock 5,500 divided by 2. So you'll get average stock 7,000. And fourth quarter, opening stock 5,500 plus closing stock 0 divided by 2. So your average stock is 2,750. Now, inventory holding cost was 18 per unit per quarter on average inventory. 18 per unit for one quarter. So 18 per unit into average stock, number of units. 18 per unit into number of units of average stock. If you multiply, keep 18 constant, multiply by average inventory, you will get this inventory holding cost 45,000, 121,500, 126,000, and 49,500. And take the total, your total inventory holding cost is 342,000. Is that okay? Total inventory holding cost is 342,000. This is one important calculation. Remaining calculation is little simpler. Now let us calculate the production cost. We have already calculated target cost above. So this is our target cost 204. Now let us see what will be the cost as per the present production plan. First, let us take cost of raw material. Each unit requires 4 kg of raw material. You can refer the question into 19 per kg. So 4 kg into rupees 19 per kg is the material required for 1 unit. Now I have done this adjustment into 100 upon 95. Now why it was done? Because 5% of the incoming material is of substandard quality. So that is a loss to you. It means if you purchase material worth rupees 100, 5% will get lost. So you can use only material worth 95% will get, 95 rupees will get consumed in the production. It means to consume 95, you'll have to buy and pay for 100. For 95, you have to pay for 100. Then for 4 into 19, what you can do? So either divide it by 95% or into 100 upon 95 you do. So that 5% loss adjustment is done. So if you do into 100 upon 95, it itself means divided by 95%. Using or cross multiplication also you can do. For 95, you have to pay 100. So for 4 kg into 19, how much? So you will get 80 per unit. 80 per unit of output now. And 80 per unit into 50,000 units for entire year. So 80 per unit into 50,000 units, you will get 40 lakhs. This is the material cost for entire production, annual production. Now we move to labor cost. 0.4 hours into rupees 120 per hour. So you will get 48 per unit. 48 per unit into 50,000 units. You will get 24 lakhs. Now variable overheads were different for different quarters. Now we had decided to produce 12,500 units every quarter. So 12,500 units for quarter 1 into 22 rupees per unit. Then 12,500 units for quarter 2 into again 22 per unit. This was given in the question. Okay, you can refer the question. Then 12,500 units for third quarter into 24 rupees and 12,500 units into 25 rupees. That is what is given in the question. So we can't help. Generally, variable cost per unit remains constant, but it was given different for different quarters. So multiply all four of them and take the memory plus. So 12,500 into 22, again 12,500 into 22, 12,500 into 24 and 12,500 into 25. Memory plus 4 times and recall memory will be 11,62,500. Now we go to fixed overheads because we have to calculate total cost. The question is asking you to calculate total cost. Fixed overheads are 6,25,000 per quarter into 4 quarters. So you'll get 25 lakhs. Okay. And these costs, that is material, labor, variable and fixed overheads, doesn't include the inventory holding cost that was written in the question. So inventory holding cost we have to take separately. So this 3,42,000 is taken here. That is why we did that working. 3,42,000 was not included in these costs, above costs. So that will be taken separately. And now if you take the grand total, that is total of everything, material, labor, variable, fixed overheads, I think your total cost comes to 1,04,4,500. Calculation part you can check, there is no problem. But this is the cost of 1 year, and in 1 year you will be producing 50,000 units. So if this 1,04,4,500 is divided by 50,000 units, do this calculation because question is asking you to calculate cost per unit. So your cost per unit comes to 208.09. Whereas our target cost was, if you check here, our target cost was 204. So difference or gap they wanted us to calculate, the cost gap. So 208.09 is the cost as per the plan, minus 204 is the target cost. So gap is 4.09 per unit. This gap has to be reduced if you want to achieve the target cost. Is this part clear? First part of the question, then we'll move to the second part. Okay, so I take you to the second part of the question now. Second part of the question, A2, this part. It says, discuss how just-in-time purchasing and just-in-time production will remove the cost gap calculated in one above and show the calculations in support of your answer. It means now the question is asking you to recalculate that cost using JIT system, just-in-time system, and see how that cost gap gets removed. So we'll have to calculate and then only check because we'll have to support our working. Now, just-in-time purchasing and just-in-time production means what? You have studied JIT system earlier. You will buy the raw material as much as required. You will not keep it in stock. Point number one. Second number, just-in-time production means you will produce as much as you can sell. So now our production plan will match with sales quantity. So whatever is quarterly sales will be equal to quarterly production. Now see in the question. This is your quarterly sales. These four quantities. We will produce also this much. Like in quarter 1, we will produce 7,500 only. and will sell 7,500. Please remember, there won't be any stock left. In JIT system, there won't be any stock. In quarter 2, we'll produce 9,000, we'll sell 9,000. In quarter 3, we'll produce 15,500, we'll sell 15,500. Now, as there is no stock, please remember, there will not be any inventory holding cost. So, inventory holding cost will become zero. But what will happen? Please remember, our normal production capacity is to produce 12,500 units. It's written where it is. No, it is 15,000 units, I think it is. Normal production capacity is 15,000 toys. And above 15,000, we have to pay 50% extra to the worker, because we have to pay them at the rate of 150% of normal wages. Now, what will happen here? 15,500 units you will produce, out of which 15,000 units you can produce in normal capacity, but 500 units you'll have to produce using overtime working. So, you'll have to pay overtime wages extra 50%. That is overtime premium. And here, out of 18,000, 15,000 we will produce in normal capacity. So, extra 3,000 units we'll have to produce in overtime. So, your overtime premium calculation will increase. Are you getting that? And inventory holding cost will be saved. And we'll see the revised cost again. So, let's go to that answer now. This is the answer. Calculation of cost as per JIT system. I've written here. You will not find such kind of notes written in the institute's answer. Please remember. Under JIT system, we will produce only as much as we can sell. Similarly, we'll purchase the raw material only as much as required for production. Under JIT, we won't carry any stock of finished goods, hence there will be no inventory holding cost. However, we have to incur the overtime wages beyond the normal capacity of 15,000 toys per quarter. And under JIT, sales quantity is equal to production quantity for each quarter. Now, one working is saved. Which working is saved? Inventory holding cost working is saved. Now, let us go to the production cost. Check. Cost of raw material, 4 kg into 19 per kg into that 100 upon 95 to accommodate that 5% substandard quality material, that is 5% loss on purchase material. So, this 80 per unit will remain unchanged. 80 per unit into 50,000 units produced, same 40 lakh. Here there is no change. Again, labor 0.4 per hour into 120 per hour. Your labor cost per unit of output is 48. 48 into 50,000 units, 24 lakh. These two figures have not changed. Now, overtime premium we will take. Please remember, here in 48 rupees when I took it 48 for entire 50,000 units. It means I have considered the normal wages of entire production of 50,000 units. Please remember, I have taken that 100% wages or normal wages for entire production. Now, I have to take only extra 50% wages, that is overtime premium. That will be payable only in quarter 3 and 4. So, check overtime premium only. Because a question will again arise in your mind, I am taking only 50% extra. So, you will say, why not 150%? Please remember, original wages are already considered for entire production. I am taking extra 50% only. That is called premium amount. Quarter 3, 15,500 minus 500 units. So, extra were 500 units. 500 units into 24. Now, from where I got 24? 48 rupees per unit into 50% extra. So, 50% extra I am only taking now, 24 rupees, okay? And how much total wages we have considered? 48 per unit plus extra 24. 48 per unit is considered for entire 50,000 units, right? And I am taking only extra 50% now for additional units produced in overtime. So, into 24, this 24 rupees is 50% extra. That is 12,000 overtime premium you have to pay in quarter 3 and quarter 4. 18,000 minus 15,000, which we had discussed, into again that 50% extra 24 rupees, this is 72,000. And this total, 84,000 is your overtime premium only. Now, variable overheads. Variable overheads are different for different quarters. And now our production is equal to sales. So, sales quantity, which is equal to production quantity, into 22 per unit, 9,000 into 22, 15,500 into 24, and 18,000 into 25. Per unit cost is given in the question into number of units. This cost total comes to 11,85,000. And fixed overheads will remain same, that is 6,25,000 per quarter into 4 quarters. That is, this is the fixed overheads. If you take the total of all this, and there is no inventory holding cost. So the revised total cost comes to 1,01,69,000. 1,01,69,000 divided by 50,000 units produced. And now the cost comes to 203.38. and this cost is below our target cost of 204. It means we could achieve the target cost, right? We are below the target cost, which is good. Cost lower than target cost is always better. So we could achieve the target cost using GIT system. Okay. Now there is one more view given by ICAI, though I am not very happy with that, but I have to discuss. Now, ICAI answer has assumed that under GIT system, there will be no substandard material from supplier. Now, this they have assumed. If you read the question, it is nowhere written in the question that when you buy the material on GIT system, that 5% substandard material won't arise. Is it mentioned anywhere in the question? You can read on your own. It's nowhere written. But institute took the approach that under GIT system, will select the best supplier who will supply defect-free material. This is assumption in their mind. So, which means our supplier will supply the best quality raw material, and hence the adjustment of 5% substandard material will not be required. This is the assumption of the institute. And in such case, material cost per unit will be only 4 into 19 rupees per kg, that is 76 per unit of output. So that adjustment of into 100 upon 95 is not required as per institute's view. So your cost will further reduce. We have taken 80 per unit, if you remember, instead of this 76, we have taken 80 because we have done this adjustment. Institute didn't do that adjustment by making their own assumption that under GIT the material will be defect free. So this will result into further saving. How much you will save? 4 per unit of output you will save. Instead of 80, if you take 76, you will save 4 rupees per unit on 50,000 units. So 2 lakh rupees will get saved. So your cost will reduce further by 2 lakh rupees. So this 1 crore 169,000 minus 2 lakh saving because of that 5% loss won't arise. So your cost can become 99,69,000, and then divided by 50,000 units, the cost will be further lower. This is another view, but according to me, you have to write an assumption if you take this view. Now, I have written my note. As the question is completely silent about such a saving under GIT system, I have preferred to calculate it by ignoring that saving of 2 lakh, right? And ICAI has considered both the views as correct. It means if you ignore the saving, still it is okay. And if you consider the saving of 2 lakh, still it is okay. ICAI will give you the marks for both the approaches, because ICAI suggested answer gives both the approaches for examiner to check. Okay. I prefer first approach, right? That is this one, which I have solved, 80 per unit instead of 76 per unit of output. And let's check what is the third part of the question, that is B part. B part says, explain how implementation of GIT production system can be a major source of competitive advantage and success of the company. So again, a theory question for 4 marks, that how GIT system will help you to stay ahead of the competitors and will lead to success. That is theory answer, which you can read, right? It's written here, theory answer. So you can go through it on your own. I'm moving ahead. Question number three. AKG Limited has 3 autonomous divisions. What do you mean by autonomous? Autonomy means you give the decision-making authority to that divisional manager only. Then we call it as autonomous. We say autonomous college, autonomous university, right? So where interference is less, the division can take its own decision and go ahead. So it has 3 autonomous divisions. The divisions are evaluated on the basis of ROI. So ROI, return on investment, is the way the performance will be measured, with year-end bonus given to divisional managers who have the highest ROI. So the divisional manager which gives the highest ROI will get rewarded, will get the bonus. Operating results of division 2 for the last year are given below. So they have given you the operating results of division 2 for the last year. Sales 2 crore 10 lakh, less variable cost or variable expenses 1 crore 26 lakh, contribution margin is 84 lakh. Less fixed expenses 67 lakh 20,000, net operating income is 16 lakh 80,000, and division's operating assets are 52 lakh 50,000. Let's go ahead. The company's overall ROI for the last year was 18%. This was overall ROI, 18% of last year, considering all divisions. So this is average ROI of the company, return on investment of the company on an average. Is 18%. Now, division 2 has an opportunity to add a new product. opportunity to add a new product line that would require an investment of rupees 30 lakhs. This division 2, whose data was given, it has an opportunity to introduce a new product on which investment of 30 lakhs is required, and other details of the new product line are as follows. Sales will be rupees 90 lakh per annum. Variable expenses, that is variable cost, will be 65% of sales. We call it as variable cost ratio. Fixed expenses 25 lakh 20,000 per annum. And the life cycle of the product line is 5 years. The product will remain in the market for 5 years. Now, though Division 2 is performing well, but many a times the customers complained that they had to wait for long after placing the orders. The company is interested in cutting the amount of time required, amount of time between when a customer places an order and when the order is completed. For last year, the following data was reported in respect of Division 2. Inspection time 0.5 days per batch. Processing time is 2.8 days per batch. Waiting time or wait time is 16 days per batch. Okay, that is very huge, 16 days per batch. Queue time, goods are in the queue, 4 days per batch. And move time, when goods are moving from one place to another, is 0.7 days per batch. Okay, this is the data. Now, in addition to financial performance measures, the company wishes to introduce a variety of non-financial performance measures also. The company has set aggressive targets in both sales growth and ROI for the coming year. The company's strategy for achieving these goals includes a campaign aimed at building brand recognition, customer retention, improvement in product quality, on-time delivery to customers, expansion of eco-friendly product lines, and introduction of limited edition items. Required. Oh, there are so many questions. Question is for 1 plus 2 plus 2 5 8. Oh my god, small questions. Total number of marks are 10, but there are so many questions. And then there is question B also. This is total 12 marks plus 8 marks B question. Okay, so total 20 marks question total together. Okay, we'll go one by one. Let us hit one by one. Calculate the last year's ROI of Division 2. Okay, very simple question. Last year's ROI of Division 2. How to get it? Actually, you don't need my help. I'm going eat slowly, digest properly policy. Right? So, we'll discuss one and we'll discuss the solution. Check this operating income divided by this assets, means profit divided by investment. Check what is the ROI. That is 16,80,000. Divided by 52,50,000 into 100. I think 32%. So for 1 mark ROI, just let us take the answer. Yes, this is 32%. Now what is the second part of the question? Let's go one by one. So this is started. Second says, discuss whether the manager of Division 2 would accept or reject the new product line if it takes his decision based solely on Division's ROI. Okay, if his decision is based only on ROI, will he accept or reject the offer of new product line? So, I'll take you back to the question. Check, this is the data of new product line. Now what you do, from 90 lakhs sales, deduct 65 lakhs variable cost. This is the data. 90 lakhs sales, deduct the variable cost 65%. You will get contribution, and from contribution deduct the fixed cost. You will get profit. Calculate that profit, and the profit divided by this investment 30 lakhs. Now I am assuming that this fixed cost includes the depreciation on this investment. Actually, investment could be investment in fixed assets plus working capital, so we don't know. But whatever is the fixed asset investment, on that depreciation is considered here. That is what I am assuming already. So, because they have not said fixed cost excluding depreciation. So, it includes everything. Let us assume. So, calculate contribution minus fixed cost. You will get profit. Profit divided by 30 lakhs into 100. Check what is the new ROI. Calculated the new ROI for this question. How much it comes to? It must be printed here. Right. The sales minus variable cost, contribution minus fixed cost, and this is controllable profit, that is which is in the control of that division, and divided by investment. So it comes to 21%. Okay, now without going further, this is first calculation of ROI. Now, will this divisional manager accept this proposal or not? So you have to think about it, your opinion. Now, please remember, he won't accept this. Why? Because his existing ROI is 32%. If on additional investment, the ROI is 21%, the average ROI of division 2 will reduce. Please try to understand, average return on investment will go down because the new product line will generate lesser return than the earlier returns. Now you'll say that what is 18%? 18% return was overall for the entire company. But division 2 is doing better and division 2 ROI will go down. Average ROI, the working is given here, check. The manager of division 2 would be unwilling to invest additional 30 lakhs because this would decrease the division 2's ROI from existing 32%, it will go down to 28%. Now, how 28% is calculated? It is weighted average ROI. See, this profit earlier you were earning, fresh profit 6,30,000 you will earn additional, right? 16,80,000 original plus additional profit. Divided by, this is divided by sign, original investment plus additional investment. So total returns divided by total investment into 100, you will notice this is called weighted average ROI. It will go down from 32% to 28%. And divisional manager's bonus is lying in the ROI maximization. So as the ROI of division 2 will go down, he will be reluctant to invest. Okay, that is the answer of second part of the question. Now let's go to third part of the question, this one. Advise how residual income approach can be used as an alternative financial measure for evaluation of managerial performance in the best interest of the company. So they want you to switch over from ROI approach to residual income approach. You know, residual income is income minus cost of capital. Now they have not given you specifically cost of capital, but what we will do, as the question says, overall return of all divisions is 18%. It means if you invest the money in any other division also, on an average, you are expected to get 18%. So if you are going to earn more than 18%, that remaining extra income is your residual income. So we will assume this 18% as cost of capital. And it will be very simple now. How very simple? Just check this. This profit we had calculated here, 6,30,000. Now from here, you have to deduct the opportunity cost or cost of capital, 30 lakhs into 18%. If you deduct from 6,30,000, the remaining income will be residual income. And as you know, we have already earned 21%, which means it is greater than 18%, 3% greater. So that extra 3% which you will earn will be residual income and that will be positive. So if you go by residual income approach, the project should be undertaken. That is what must be written here. So check here. Generally, a manager who is evaluated based on ROI will reject any project whose rate of return is below the division's current ROI, even if the rate of return of the project is above the company's minimum required rate of return. In contrast, managers who are evaluated using residual income will pursue any project whose return is above the minimum required rate of return because it will increase their residual income. So in the best interest of the company as a whole, residual income approach can be used for evaluation of managerial performance. So for the investment decision of division 2, the residual income calculations are as follows. Proposed investment 30 lakh, controllable profit of that division is 6,30,000. On this 30 lakh, 18% is deducted from here and you get residual income 90,000, which is extra 3%. This 90,000 can be directly calculated as extra 3% on 30 lakhs. 30 lakhs into 3% also you'll get 90,000. Are you getting it? See, your return was 21% on new product, whereas expected rate of return is 18%. So, advice is residual income is more likely to make correct investment decision and so is probably the safer basis than ROI on which to measure the performance. Anyway, that is the theory, few lines. Check the next question. Okay, next question, that is fourth part, A4, is calculate a manufacturing cycle efficiency. Manufacturing cycle efficiency and interpret the result for 3 marks. Very simple. If you remember, in manufacturing cycle efficiency, what you do, we take in the numerator the time taken by the activity which are value-added activities. And in the denominator, we take total time which is taken to complete the production, total time. So out of total time, how much is value added time? Remaining is non-value added time. If the value added time is higher, the efficiency is higher. If the value added time is lower, the efficiency is lower. That is the interpretation. And I think it can be calculated very easily from this data. Check this data now. Check this data. If you add all this, you will get total time for producing one batch. That is 0.5 days plus 2.8 plus 16 plus 4 plus 0.7. Just take the total. 0.5 plus 2.8 plus 16 plus 4 plus 0.7. Total is 24 days to produce one batch. Out of which take which is value added and which is non-value added. Value added time is where actual manufacturing is going on. That is process time. You can refer the formula of MCE. It is given in your regular batch notes. This is the only value added time. 2.8. Inspection time, wait time, queue time, move time. In this, no production is going on. So basically, they are non-value added time. So 2.8 divided by 24 days. 2.8 days divided by 24 days into 100. You will get that MCE percentage. I think it will be very low percentage. So check the answer. This is the answer. Right, processing time, that is value added time in the numerator, divided by total time, it's just 11.67%. So interpretation is, in AKG, the MCE is 11.67%, which means that remaining 100 minus 11.67 is remaining 83.33% of the time a unit is in process is spent on activities that do not add value. So 88.33% is non-value added time and 11.67% is value added time. Right, so that is what is written. Now let us check the next part of the question, what it says. Fifth part, state what percentage of production time is spent on non-value added activities. Okay, that we have already given, 88.33%. What percentage of production time is spent on non-value added? This is also carrying one mark. Now calculate the delivery cycle time. That we calculated the total delivery cycle time is 24 days per batch, total time from when you get the order from the customer and finally you deliver the goods. So all these answers were already ready, right? Non-value added was 88.33%, delivery cycle time is 24 days. Now next question was, calculate the new MCE by using lean production, by using lean system, lean and thin system, you know. By using lean production, all queue time can be eliminated. Okay, so we have to calculate new manufacturing cycle efficiency using lean production system where all queue time can be eliminated. Now all queue time will have to interpret, so that will get eliminated. So queue time actually is only one given here, 4 days. Now if you assume that wait time is also a queue time, we'll have to write a note that if we assume wait time is also queue time, then 16 days further will get reduced. Otherwise just queue time is 4 days. So from your non-value added time, 4 days will go up away. And total time will become 24 minus 4. If you take 16 days also, then the answer will be different. So I think there will be two answers, assuming whatever assumption Institute has made. Let us see. Check. First of all, this non-value added time is already there. Total deliveries cycle time is 24 days. Revised MCE. In numerator, we'll take processing time 2.8 days. In the denominator, this 4 days are reduced. This has made 0. So it will become 2.8 days divided by 20 days instead of 24 days. Just check 2.8 divided by 20 days into 100. Right, it is 14%. So slightly your efficiency will go up. And one more opinion is given. Alternative view on revised MC. If you assume that wait time of 16 days is also removed by lean production system, that is in queue time, you can remove 16 days also. Then the calculation shall be, in the denominator you will get total time as 0.5 plus 2.8 plus 0.7. Two things have gone there, 4 days have gone and this 16 days have gone. 4 days queue time was given and waiting time if also assumed to be removed by lean system. So denominator was earlier 24 days, this 20 days gone. So denominator is only 4 days now and 2.8 out of 4 days. So your efficiency will sharply increase, 2.8 days divided by 4 days into 100. So it will go to 70%. So you can give two answers, 70% and 14% to be on safer side by writing a note. Are you getting it? So Institute will give you the marks for either of the answer. Now what was the next question?
बी पार्ट, चेक व्हाट बी पार्ट सेज. बेस्ड ऑन द अबव इंफॉर्मेशन एंड यूजिंग स्ट्रेटजी मैप टैब्यूलेट टू ऑब्जेक्टिव्स एंड टू मेजर्स फॉर ईच पर्सपेक्टिव अक्रॉस द फोर डायमेंशंस ऑफ अ बैलेंस स्कोर कार्ड. ओके, सो हियर दे वांट बैलेंस स्कोर कार्ड. इन बैलेंस स्कोर कार्ड वी डिवाइड इट इन फोर पर्सपेक्टिव. इफ यू रिमेंबर द पर्सपेक्टिव्स आर फाइनेंशियल पर्सपेक्टिव, कस्टमर पर्सपेक्टिव, राइट, इंटरनल ग्रोथ पर्सपेक्टिव एंड लर्निंग पर्सपेक्टिव, राइट. सो देर आर फोर पर्सपेक्टिव. अंडर ईच पर्सपेक्टिव यू हैव टू गिव द ऑब्जेक्टिव एंड अंडर ईच ऑब्जेक्टिव यू विल गिव द मेजर, हाउ यू विल मेजर द परफॉर्मेंस फॉर दैट ऑब्जेक्टिव. Now such type of questions you will find in our regular batch notes also, right? Some examples are given in regular batch notes. Now here the answer from for each student will be different. This is basically a theory question. You have to first make the list of four perspectives, give certain objectives to be achieved in that perspective, and how you will measure the performance of that perspective, means how you will calculate that your objective is achieved or not. So this answer can be different for different students. The answer must be already printed, which you can go through. Right, there are financial perspective, customer perspective, internal perspective, and learning and innovation perspective. Some objectives are written, some measures are written, and a note is also written. Any logically correct answer is valid in the above case. Right, any logically, because everybody's answer will be different here. So this you can just go through. Institute has provided this answer. You can develop your own answer, and some examples are already lying in your regular batch notes. So we have covered two questions. I think first was case study, so I skipped. Second and third question. Now next discussion will be from question number 4, but I think I should stop here for today. It's already around 1 hour, I think. So remaining discussion from question 4 onwards we'll do in the next lecture, right? I hope this discussion will at least help you to understand the practical questions little better, or the calculation little better. That is what my objective of recording these lectures is. If you are able to understand it without my discussion, then don't waste time on my video lectures, right? You can directly read from printed notes, understand it on your own. Always welcome. On the contrary, that will give you better insight. But if you are finding difficulty in understanding the answers calculated, right, through your printed notes, then you can refer my video lectures for little more clarity. That's the only purpose. Okay, friends, so I'll stop here for the day, right? See you tomorrow, right? Tomorrow's lecture will be lecture number 4, and we will continue also from question 4A. Okay, bye-bye.